Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 13 of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast. This week, I have the delight of chatting with Miss Dorie Clark. Dorie is a strategy consultant, pro speaker, and professor at Duke University. She's consulted for all the big names you can think of, including Google, Morgan Stanley, and Yale University. She's a regular contributor for Forbes magazine and Harvard Business Review. She's also the author of the books Reinventing You and Stand Out. And her first book, Reinventing You, was named the number one leadership book of 2015 by Inc. magazine. This was an awesome interview, and her accomplishments can only be outdone by her humility and class. So without further ado, let's get into our interview with Ms. Dorie Clark. Dorie, thanks so much for taking the time to talk with me.
Hey, thank you so much for having me.
So you are a bona fide heavy hitter in the professional digital marketing space. You write for Harvard Business Review and Forbes. You teach for Harvard. But it wasn't always like that. And nobody starts at the top of the mountain. Plus, the road to professional digital marketing tends to be a winding one. So take us on that journey. Tell us that story. When did you first get bit by the bug? And how did you become enchanted with digital marketing?
Yeah, thank you very much. Well, I actually started my business now about 10 years ago, and the immediate precursor to it was that I was running a nonprofit organization. It was actually a small bicycling advocacy organization in Boston, and for 2 years, I was the executive director there, and prior to that, I had worked in politics. I had been a journalist, but about a year into running this nonprofit, I had a kind of revelation that hit me, which was that, you know, oh, wait a minute, running this nonprofit is basically running a business, and I thought, oh my gosh, I could do that for myself. And it just hit me that would be, I'd never considered entrepreneurship before that, but it hit me that would be a really awesome thing to do. And so because I had worked in politics and in journalism, I had some experience in communication, I realized that would be a good direction to go in. So I spent the next year, the second year of working at the nonprofit, really trying to build my skills. I took adult ed classes. I read a million books, all focused on what it would be like to start my business so that I could at least theoretically be ready. And because this was, now 10 plus years ago, 2006 that I was launching, that was really when a lot of online and digital communications were starting to grow. That was, when YouTube was launching, when Facebook was first starting to be offered to people outside of college campuses. Twitter launched in 2006. So it was kind of an inflection point. And a lot of my clients that I first got were very interested in / concerned by social media. They realized they didn't know what to do. And so that was often one of the earliest projects that I would get to work on for clients. So that's how I entered the digital communications realm.
Gotcha. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted with professional digital marketing? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that sort of shiny veneer come off and like, okay, it's time to get down to brass tacks?
Well, one of the things that I learned early on that was really interesting, this wasn't necessarily so much a problem with digital marketing as it was with the disjunct of client expectations, is that early on in my business, clients very much had a mindset that was created 5 years, 10 years, 20 years prior. And one of the great frustrations that I had was in, starting this business 2006, 2007, they were expecting they could do things like, oh, we're going to have a press conference and you'll send a press release and then 20 reporters will show up. And I had to tell them, like, there aren't 20 reporters anymore. Journalism has been decimated. There is no such thing. Like, you know, Donald Trump can barely get 20 reporters in a room. That's why he uses Twitter, is because nobody's coming to press availabilities anymore. And, you know, they'd get mad that, like, oh, they weren't getting on the front page of the paper. And you'd have to say, look, you know, in the past 5 years, have you noticed that the paper is 30% smaller than it used to be? There's not the room. And so they were expecting communications results that were from a previous era. And so then when digital communications came up, they didn't know what to make of it. They knew that you should be doing something, but they weren't sure exactly what. They weren't sure how to measure the results. I mean, of course, we still talk about that today. But even there, they would have sort of unrealistic expectations. You know, why? Well, why doesn't our, you know, tiny organization have a million followers like Ashton Kutcher? And you kind of have to walk people through when there's a new sort of channel being developed, the norms haven't been codified. And so that was something that definitely was challenging in the early days.
Yeah, it's a pickle. Michael Becker, he's a thought leader in the mobile space, and he has a saying that marketing has changed more in the last 2 years than in the preceding 50. But a lot of people's mindsets just haven't caught up, and it could be a challenge trying to communicate that to clients. So I absolutely agree with that. If you had a time machine, you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I'm a Doctor Who fan. What are the top three things that you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
Yeah, great question. And, you know, certainly important for all of us to be thinking about. I mean, I think one thing that was, you know, possibly I think on the whole a blessing, although somewhat of a curse, was that I went to a liberal arts college, and I loved doing that. I was a philosophy major, and studied a lot of literature. I then got a master's degree in theology, and so, you know, I wasn't really taking business classes, which I think is fine because a lot of business classes are not necessarily all that helpful. But the problem that I felt was not so much that I didn't, you know, literally take a class in how to do marketing, because, I mean, whatever, you can do a lot better just by doing. But I think that in some ways there was a failure of imagination as a result of it, because for a long time I was very set on the idea of having a career as an academic, because that was kind of all I knew. And it's almost like, you know, when you're a little kid, you know that there's firemen and astronauts and, you know, police officers and doctors, and that's pretty much like the only careers you think are available. And I feel like in some ways in liberal arts schools, that sort of persists. I mean, the universe gets a little bit bigger, but you don't necessarily realize within the business world that there are so many options and so many opportunities. And it's not that I wanted to necessarily study those things, but I think if I could go back in time and just somehow make myself aware or be made aware that, you know, the biggest stereotype was I worried that a career in business would be boring. I thought, oh, you know, it's just, you're going to be like Dilbert or whatever, right, Stuck in a cubicle. And I would like to just sort of go back and allow myself to understand that there is a world of options and a world of opportunities. And business is actually one of the most stimulating things out there. It's kind of this cauldron in which you can test yourself, and it's incredibly fulfilling. But I really didn't have that grounding when I was younger.
Gotcha. So you teach at the university level, you teach at Harvard, and I had Mark Schaefer on the show last week, and he teaches at Rutgers, and he was very frank that he thinks that the current state of professional digital marketing education is pathetic, which it can certainly use a shot in the arm. And then you have somebody on the opposite extreme, somebody like a Gary Vaynerchuk, who would just say that they don't teach what you need to know at all. I know just from reading your books that you're with it, and so nobody taking your class is getting stale information. What is your assessment of the professional digital marketing landscape in terms of formal education, and what would you say to a young person who may have heard Gary V say that, okay, forget going to college because you're not going to learn anything?
Well, thank you. I think it really is an important thing to to think about and address. One point just to clarify is the teaching that I do is for the Fuqua School of Business at Duke. You're right that I have a Harvard affiliation, but it's that Harvard Business Review Press is my publisher. Gotcha. And I often blog for the Harvard Business Review, but for teaching I do it at Duke, which is also, of course, a fantastic school. But, you know, I think that there are certainly some people. I mean, you know, Gary himself will be the first to say, college or whatever, graduate schools, that didn't work for him. He was not interested in being a student. He was not a good student by his own admission. So I think that there are some people that if being in a classroom is kind of an uphill battle for you, you know, like if it's just something that's like, oh, you hate it, it's boring, it's terrible, there are certain personality types that are like that, then you know, absolutely don't force yourself. That's not mandatory. There are many, many ways to learn. And if you know yourself well enough to know that you learn in a different way better, then do that. You know, something that does bother me tremendously is the idea that that one particular path, that, you know, the having a college degree is somehow mandatory for people. Right. I think that education is mandatory for people, but there are a lot of ways to obtain an education, and college is one of them. Now, in terms of how digital marketing in particular is taught at them, I agree with Mark for sure that the techniques, things that are being taught, really are, you know, by and large, not being addressed at the college or, you know, MBA level. I think part of that is a function of academia itself, because the way that new material is integrated into the curriculum, unless an individual professor says, "Oh, I'm gonna make this a little part of my class. I'll do a little section on it or whatever." But in terms of actually having a particular course dedicated to something or a program dedicated to something, that is a process where a group of academics have to vote to change the curriculum. And so you have to build consensus among your colleagues. You're always going to have people saying, oh, well, maybe this is just a fad. Maybe, you know, we shouldn't jump on this bandwagon. We have to see if it sticks. And of course, you know, 10 years later, okay, digital media isn't a fad, but it's changed so profoundly from when they were first considering doing it that the ideas that they were talking about back then have even changed in the interim. So it very much is not being addressed. For anything that is rapidly changing, it's hard for academia to do it, because the system that's set up to transmit wisdom that has been received over time, it's they're the historians, they're not the journalists, they're not the ones that are necessarily tracking things that are happening in real time. So if you're looking to do digital marketing, getting an MBA is probably a pretty poor use of your time. There are a lot of things that an MBA is good for. I would say that's probably not one of them if you want that to be your principal focus.
And that's an important distinction you just made, that the system of transmitting knowledge, it wasn't set up to handle this, kind of like our legal system when you first had, you know, file sharing and the whole Napster thing. Just the way it's set up, you know, the Supreme Court justices, they're really good at the law, but I wouldn't necessarily trust any of them to handle something in the digital space, right? Because it just wasn't set up that way. So awesome. We're going to take a short break, and when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Dorie Clark, so stick with me. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry, this is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately, most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill. which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. And we're back. So, Dorie, in the last question, I asked your opinion about digital marketing and academia. Now I want to switch more so to the professional practitioner level because you also speak. So you, Gary V, and Brian Solis, you're all chilling at the bar after a conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing landscape, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Yeah, so interesting. Because things are moving so quickly, I think that a trend that digital marketers, and I think Brian and Gary are amazing. They're sort of on the forefront. But when I'm talking about digital marketers, I sort of mean the universe of practitioners writ large. I think that there is sometimes a paranoia that because things are moving so fast, you do not want to be the one left behind. Right. And so there is this kind of fear of that, and consequently, people are, I think, almost too often wanting to jump on the new thing, the next thing, whatever that might be, almost sometimes regardless of how well that maps to your client's interests. Because, here's this new thing. We have to use this new thing. We have to jump on it so that we can get this early mover advantage. And, of course, sometimes that works out and is great. And, it is useful. And we have enough examples of that, being on Twitter in 2006, 2007. You can, as a regular person, get a million followers that way because Twitter is suggesting you and things like that. That's extraordinarily powerful. But for every example like that, and of course Twitter now is even faltering a bit, you have something like Google+, where you have people, the Guy Kawasaki's of the world writing books. Oh, here's what you need to know about Google+. Hop on Google+. This is going to be the next great thing. And of course, it fizzles. It basically doesn't even exist now. Except for its sort of nominal identity, or God forbid, you have Elo.
Right.
And I remember a couple of years ago, I did something. I mean, like some kind of minor favor for somebody that I kind of casually knew over the internet. Somebody, mm-hmm. maybe they wanted an introduction to somebody, or they, wanted some advice. And so I sent them an email and I did the thing for them. And they said, "Oh, Dorie, thank you. I'm so grateful. I want to repay you. I want to do something for you. Do you want an invitation to Elo?" Because it was like, "Oh, it's invitation only." And of course, this was a very nice gesture. I appreciate it, because people at the time, they were like literally taking to Facebook, taking to Twitter, saying, "Oh, can someone get me an invitation?" And I wrote, back to the person, and I actually said, "That is so kind of you. I really appreciate it. But the last thing I want in my life is another social network. I would rather shoot myself than participate. So thank you so much, but I'm good." And so I think that we need to learn to employ discernment when it comes to what is actually going to be a great advance in innovation and what is just another thing thrashing around to make us feel useful because we have some new piece of information or something that other people are not yet on top of that we can sort of wield over them to say, "Oh, you're not on Elo? You really should be."
Right. FOMO is real, and FOMO stands for fear of missing out. And but it all has to tie back to business principles. Something that we mentioned in our book with regards to mobile marketing is that there are only three ways that businesses grow: just three, and that's to get new clients, get existing clients to spend more, or get existing clients to spend more often. Now, that business principle is literally 100 years old. They've been teaching that since forever. But you have to relate that to mobile, and that mobile is outstanding at the latter two objectives, getting existing customers to either spend more or spend more often. So could not agree with you more. Without getting political, but by all means, express yourself, because, you know, candor is the whole point of the podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news backlash / crackdown on Facebook? Because after the election results came out, and it was revealed that in the last 3 months of the election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. First, Zuckerberg tried to play it off. He was like, no. It's highly unlikely we had anything to do with that. And then when the numbers came out, he's like, okay, we're going to roll out some third party, you know, verification type of system. Where do you stand on that whole debate? Because, I mean, you could go straight First Amendment, like, no, they're a platform only. They don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. But on the other hand, you could be like, okay, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you have a pool in your backyard. And when you're away on business, some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping, and one of them drowns. You put up a fence. They was trespassing. Doesn't matter. Happened on your property, so you're responsible. So where do you fall on that whole debate?
Yeah, it certainly is a hot debate these days. I think generally I would probably take a bit of a middle path. I mean, it does – the idea of Facebook being the policeman of veracity disturbs me a little bit, just in the sense that they are not equipped to vet individual news stories, let's say. I do think that there is – a certain degree of care that they can take. I mean, the analogy that I would draw is with Twitter and hate speech, which has also been aired a lot. I think that if there is, for Twitter and hate speech, I mean, for a long time, they really didn't do anything. They're just like, oh, we can't help you, blah, blah, blah. Eventually, public outcry was sufficient enough that they said, okay, we're going to take some action. And so I think that that in both cases, if some account proves itself over time to be a serial offender, then they should be taken down because they're just a bad player. I think that for individual pieces, I mean, the situation you don't want is for Facebook to be drawn in some way so that they're being expected to adjudicate between the Washington Times, which is a notorious right-wing publication, and the Washington Post, which is, you know, typically more centrist to left. And, you know, they're going to have different takes. But yeah, if there is an outfit that is creating alien stories out of Latvia to get clicks, and that seems to be the entire raison d'etre of what they're doing. I think that Facebook can help, but we can't rely on Facebook to be our gatekeeper. That actually relaxes our civic responsibility, I think, too much. I mean, really, for me, the biggest key is, who are these people reading the fake news, and why do they not understand that it's fake? I mean, you know, for someone who reads, student papers, college student papers, graduate student papers, if someone uses Wikipedia as their reference, you send it back. Yep. You say, Wikipedia is not a reference. I'm sorry, kids. Find something legitimate. And if we have a group of people, I mean, obviously it has rather dire consequences for our civic life, but I don't understand why you have grown-ups that don't understand that you need to check where something comes from. I point the blame at ourselves. I point the blame at America if we are not educated to be able to tell the difference between something that is credible and something that is not.
People want their information spoon-fed to them, and that just sets you up to be manipulated. And you're absolutely right. People have a responsibility to check their sources, and I couldn't agree more. So, last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. And I do appreciate you taking the time. And I am going to take just a couple minutes to set it up. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast. And you actually introduced me to him in your standout book, by the way. So I
Oh,
do appreciate
nice.
that. Yeah, it was cool. I've been listening ever since. What I'm trying to, I want you to understand why I'm asking this question the way I am, because I'm trying to crowdsource a way to professionalize yourself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, because there's a lot of good information out there, but you might land on Harvard Business Review. You might end up in Amway. Like, who knows? Another path that you can take is you can get a degree like I did, but that's expensive and time consuming, or you can go to conferences, but that also can get expensive. So I'm trying to crowdsource a way to if you want to professionalize yourself that doesn't include those three sort of standard tracks. So, last question is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still had all the skills and experience you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, Dory. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
So I will tell you what I actually did when I first started my business. So for the first, I would say 2 to 3 years of running my marketing consulting practice, I just went to the library constantly, and I was reading 1 to 2 books a week. I would go and I would check out stacks of books. And fortunately, I lived close to the library, and I could walk home because it was very heavy to carry all of them. But I read literally hundreds of books, and I tried to work my way through the business classics that I thought would make me an educated person. And if I was reading a book and they would mention another book that they somehow indicated was foundational, I would go get that book. And it's easy. You just request it online. These days, they even have an app on a lot of libraries called Overdrive that allows you to request electronic or Kindle copies of the book. So you don't even have to go to the library to check them out and read them. But I read so much, and it was so necessary for me because, as I mentioned, I studied philosophy and theology. I had no exposure to these business thinkers. And if you want to present yourself as a knowledgeable professional, if you want to be somebody that people trust to solve their problems, you can't just walk in and not know who the influential people are. You can't just walk in and not know what the debates are in your industry. That immediately deflates your credibility. And so having a grounding, it does a couple of things. One is it makes you more credible to your potential clients. Number two, it gives you the ammunition you need to create your own point of view. Because once you steep yourself in it enough, you realize, oh, okay, well, some people are over here and some people are over there. And I actually think I'm more kind of over in this place, and here's why. You can formulate a reasoned opinion based on, a deep knowledge of the facts. That allows you to have to bring your own sauce to the table in an informed way. And then the third piece, you were asking, how would you connect with these opinion leaders? And what I would say, and this is something that I actually did to great effect, is that after a while, I mean, in my case, it was more than 30 days for sure. It took a couple of years, but after really becoming familiar with their work, taking it in, understanding it deeply, I began creating content. I began writing, in my case, blog posts. You could also do podcasts like this. You could do videos, whatever. But I began writing blog posts where I would write my own take on the articles, and I would oftentimes cite the work of other people. And you can then send them that article and just say, hey, I really respect your work. I quoted you in this article. I quoted you in this blog post. And that's a great way to get on people's radar because they're usually very appreciative of it. Sometimes, you know, you can't bank on this, but sometimes they will, you know, share it on social media. Oftentimes they might write back and thank you. It's just kind of a low-key way to start building a relationship. Sometimes you don't even have to mention it and they will find it, which is particularly exciting. So like David Allen, for instance, who wrote the famous book, one that I recommend for people as kind of a canonical piece of business literature, Getting Things Done. I mentioned him in an article I wrote for the Huffington Post. He saw it, you know, I guess because of Google alerts or whatever. And he contacted me and he thanked me for doing that, which was fantastic. And that enabled us to build a connection, which later led to me interviewing him for my book Stand Out. So I think that process of just reading, you know, what you can do for free at the library and then moving on to creating your own content is valuable. I mean, now that I'm an author, I like to say, you know, the minute you can afford to buy the books. But early on, you know, when you're scraping it together, there's not a thing wrong with taking advantage of the library. That's what it's there for. And it's a tremendously egalitarian force.
I cannot agree more. And as she just mentioned, you'd find, especially in the digital marketing space, a lot of people are very kind, very giving of their time. Like Dorie is way, way, way above me, but here we are talking. So Dorie, this has been tremendous. I greatly appreciate it. Please, you briefly mentioned your book, Stand Out. You also have another one, Reinventing You. Please take a moment and tell us of any upcoming projects you have, blogs, social media handles. Where can we get some more of you?
Well, thank you. So you mentioned my books that are out, Reinventing You, which is about professional reinvention, Stand Out, which is about how to become a recognized expert. I have a new book that is going to be coming out in October of 2017 called Entrepreneurial You, which is about how to actually make money from your ideas and from your business. That's going to be released by Harvard Business Review Press. And if people want to connect, I'm on Twitter, at Dorie Clark, D-O-R-I-E-C-L-A-R-K, and I also have a free resource that if people are interested, they are welcome to download. It is a 42-page self-assessment workbook that I created as a companion to my book Stand Out. And it really walks people through how to develop their own unique ideas that they can become known for and then figure out how to disseminate them. So if people are interested in kind of diving in about how they can tap into becoming a recognized expert, they can do that for free. You can just download it off my website at dorieclark.com.
There you go, folks. DorieClark.com. Get that. You want that. I read Stand Out, and I swear by it. I absolutely do. So, Dorie, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Great talking with you.
Awesome. If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.